And he said, if my people who were called by my name. See, it wasn't about the temple, it was about the people. The temple's gone. The people are still here. After 20 years, the family of carpenters worked and worked and worked, and they got all the work done, and God moved in. He liked the temple. He moved in. He said, thank you. But if my people who were called by my name, then and only then will I hear and forgive and heal. Wasn't about the temple. Wasn't about a house. It was about the people. You see, God wants our heart. He wants our heart. We'll never give Him anything until we give Him our heart. We got to give Him our heart first. You go into the book of Nehemiah and you think about the building that Nehemiah did. You know, I like Nehemiah being a builder. It's one of my favorite books, and there's a lot of details about Nehemiah that I can relate to. You know, Nehemiah's heart was broken for a place he'd never been and for a people he'd never seen. His brother was part of this delegation that came to the temple there, or to the palace, I should say. And as Nehemiah asked about the people, he said, what about the people, the remnant of those that escaped? And his brother told him that the people were in a bad way and that the walls were broken down and the gates had been burned, and what a mess it was. Nehemiah chapter 1 verse 4 says that Nehemiah sat down and he wept. His heart was broken for the people, and he prayed, and he prayed. You know, he found out about that in the fall. It was like November, December when he found out about what happened in the city of Jerusalem, and it was March before the king actually said, Nehemiah, what's wrong with you? I can see it on your face. His heart was broken for the people. King gave him everything he needed, and he went and he did the building. But Nehemiah, you know, he didn't go in a big parade with trumpeters in front of him and a big long caravan of people and saying, you know, here I come, look at me. And he went in and he kept it quiet. And he waited a few days and he went out at night and he surveyed the work that needed to be done. And he formulated a plan. And he got the people involved. He got the people involved. All the different families that lived along the wall, he had them work where they lived. He got the people involved. And Nehemiah was a smart guy. He knew his limitations. He got Ezra to do the preaching. Man's got to know his limitations. Nehemiah found a lot of things when he got to Jerusalem that broke his heart. He knew those people needed revival, and he knew they needed to get back to the Lord. And he got wind of the bad banking practices that had been going on, and he fixed it. He found a registry of the genealogy, those that returned back from Babylon, pardon me, and he cleaned up the ranks of the priests and Levites. And the people were instructed out of the law concerning many things, and there was a great revival took place. Because it wasn't about building the walls, it was about building the people. You see, the building is just a building. It's about the people. Nehemiah knew about the abuses of the Sabbath, and they would do things they weren't supposed to do on the Sabbath, and he straightened that out. He repaired the abuses in tithing, and he stopped them from taking foreign wives and all the things in the law that the people had fallen away from. He instructed them, and they read from the law. The people's hearts were broken. So let's move on to the next family of carpenters, and we'll go into the New Testament. Mark chapter 6. Go to Mark chapter 6. We're going to finish up with this one. Mark chapter 6. We'll start out in verse number 1. Talk about a family of carpenters here. And it says, he went out from thence, came into his own country, and his disciples followed him. And when the Sabbath day was come, he began to teach in the synagogue. And many hearing him were astonished, saying, from whence hath this man these things? And what wisdom is this which is given unto him, that even such mighty works are wrought by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph, and of Judah and Simon? Are not his sisters here with us? And they were offended at him. Could you imagine growing up being brothers and sisters of Jesus? Brother Jim mentioned a little while ago there that Jesus led a perfect, sinless life. Could you imagine growing up in that shadow? You know, I mean, we've all got brothers and sisters. Some of us do, I guess. And you know, if you've got a brother or a sister that was a little bit older than you and they were really good at something in school, when you came through, all the teachers said, I remember you. And, you know, they talked about how great a baseball player your brother was or how smart your sister was, and can you live up to that? Can you imagine having Jesus as your brother? Perfect Jesus. There's a family dynamic. They had to know, right? I mean, they had to know. His mom and dad knew. They had to know. If you had a perfect older brother that was absolutely perfect, my goodness, growing up in that shadow. He was God in the flesh. How much more special can you get than Jesus Christ? Jude was a non-believer until the crucifixion. He saw his brother resurrected, and in the book of Jude, he calls himself the servant of Jesus Christ. James was also a non-believer before Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. Can you imagine how much more proof would you need about Jesus' deity than to see him resurrected from death? How much more proof could you possibly need? James was martyred for his brother, thrown from the pinnacle of the temple and beaten to death. He proclaimed Jesus as the Messiah. Absolute proof, eyewitness proof, his own brother, in addition to the hundreds and probably thousands of people who saw Jesus after he was resurrected, his own brother preached Jesus. Resurrected. Truly, this was the Savior of the world. This carpenter. Son of a carpenter. At the age of 12, he said, I must be about my father's business. And at the age of 30, he left his father's business. You see, it wasn't about the building. It was about the people. Romans 5 and 8 says, God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we're yet sinners, Christ died for us. A carpenter died for me. A carpenter. He never met me. He died for me so that I could spend eternity with him. And you, by the way, he died for you too. Jesus said in Luke 19 and 10, the Son of Man has come to seek and save that which was lost. Did you ever think what was lost? What did we lose? We lost our life with God. Because of the sins in the garden, we lost our life with God. See, we're all born to die twice. Until we meet Jesus. Then we just die once and we live forever after that with him. Our spiritual death results in eternal separation from God. Our spiritual death. Eternally separated. And it's not a good place where we go. All right? That lake of fire, that hair pulling and gnashing of teeth, that's a bad place. Agony forever. But my friend the carpenter provided me a way forward. He died once for all mankind, and if we accept his gift of salvation, we make him Lord of our life. If we give him our heart, which is what he really wants, if we give him our heart, if we're born again, then we can live eternally with our Savior in paradise. Now, a commentator I read, he wrote this. He said, eternity to the godly is a day that has no sunset. And eternity to the wicked is a night with no sunrise. Does the video work? Yes? Amen. All right, we're going to play a little short video. I want you to listen to the words in the music. It's a little bit about what we do. And I want you to think about this. God knew we needed a Savior. He knew we needed a Savior. And when he sent Jesus Christ to earth, he put that little tiny baby in the hands of a carpenter. Go ahead.
Kneeling in a stable, he never left her side. Though the boy was not his baby, she was still his bride. Proving himself worthy, like true love always does. The night God put his son and his trust in the hands of a carpenter, in the hands of a carpenter. When that boy became a young man, he picked up his father's trade, working right beside him, learning more each day about the miracle that happens inside the workshop walls when you put the timber hammer and the saw in the hands of a carpenter, in the hands of a carpenter. Weathered and worn, calloused and sore, but oh, of a carpenter, in the hands of a carpenter. He left the family business at 30 years of age, and quickly gained the reputation of a righteous renegade. The religious called him sinner, and the sinner called him friend, and the blind man found his sight again. In the hands of a carpenter, in the hands of a carpenter, weathered and worn, calloused and sore, but all the healing that they when the very touch of God was felt. In the hands of a carpenter, in the hands of a carpenter, with a crossbeam on his shoulders and the thorns deep in his brow, they led him to a hillside out on the edge of town. But he only had forgiveness, not one ounce of spite, when the ones he came to save drove the spikes. In the hands of a carpenter, in the hands of a carpenter, bloodied and bruised, broken right in two, but oh, the grace and mercy that they had, with splintered wood and rusty nails. In the hands of a carpenter, in the hands of a carpenter, salvation flowed and love prevailed. The day the fate of this whole world fell, in the hands of a carpenter, in the hands of a carpenter.